Very good morning to you, Danny Bonaduce.
And a good morning to you.
Now, the character of Danny was described as quite a little smart aleck, which you played brilliantly. Is that because it was very true of yourself?
You know what? If you look at my screen record, this Partridge Family was by far not my first gig. You ready to be impressed and give me all new credit? Here we go. My first movie was with Elvis Presley. Boom, drop the mic.
Oh, boom, indeed.
Tell us more.
Well, when I get to the end of the story, you'll know that you can actually believe this. Elvis Presley gave me a car when I was 7 years old. Now, I'll walk you that walk. I got the job like I got every other job. I went on audition. My mom drove me around town, got the job. It was a movie called The Trouble with Girls, and I played a one-man band in a circus. And I said something that obviously Elvis Presley liked, and he sent a push car to my home. I don't even know how that guy knew where I lived, but he sent me a push car, and I can truthfully say I was given a car by Elvis Presley.
Tell me you've still got that, Danny.
I don't. I didn't even know it was important. I stole almost all the musical instruments from the Partridge Family, and I don't have those either. Those would be worth a fortune now.
When you're going to go to that much trouble to pinch something, you should hang on to it until you can make some money out of it. Now, some of your most memorable scenes on the show were with Dave Madden, who played the group's manager, Reuben Kincaid. How close were you two?
As close as an adult male can be with a small child and not go to jail. That sounded way worse than a minute too. You know what? I was not having an easy time at home, and everybody knew it. But Dave Madden stepped up to the plate and said, hey, why don't you spend the summer at my house on the beach? And I did, and it was not only a great respite from time with my father, but it was really a wonderful bonding experience with Dave. And when we went back to do the show after that, it was like working with your best friend, except that best friend let me smoke cigarettes. So it was even a better best friend.
You were quite the close family, and we know that you, in your younger years, really did battle some demons, but you managed to break that child star curse. You got sober, you got a successful career underway. When David Cassidy died a couple of years back, how hard was that for you? Because he had been sober, but you said that you've said in interviews previously that he then started battling alcohol addiction again. Was that hard to watch your friend's life crumble again?
Because David was never a big guy. When I was a kid, I assumed he was a large guy, that he was big. And as I grew up, and we didn't see each other for maybe 20 years, and then we got really close again, it was kind of weird to see that he was a small, thin man. And as he started to get sick and wither a little bit, he just became a kind of a shell of himself. And it broke my heart. And my wife had gotten really close with David. They were really good friends. And she was inconsolable. It was just a really rough time. And he had said, hey, why don't you come to Chicago? I'm recording a new album. And in my head, I thought, oh, man, that's going to be sad. It's not going to work. And I made an excuse. Oh, I can't go, David. Sorry. And he went to Chicago and he died there. And I just feel kind of terrible that I didn't go, even though there was nothing I could do for the man. I'm not a doctor. But it just broke my heart. He asked me to go and I didn't go. And the man died when he got to Chicago.
Do you think, Danny, that the massive fame that you all experienced due to the success of the Partridge Family played into you guys having those demons? Was it just something that was incredibly difficult to deal with?
No, you know what? I mean, it was super weird. We weren't normal famous. People get famous. People do television shows and things like that. But the Partridge Family was completely out of control in the world of fame. People screaming. This breaks my heart to tell you. This haunted David Cassidy forever. Two young ladies died at two different David Cassidy concerts. That's not a great level of fame that two young ladies died, but it'll give you an idea of the insanity. But, you know, I'll tell you what pushes you towards fighting your own demons, and that would be that everybody's fighting their demons. Look around. I was on a talk show one time. I think it was Dr. Oz. Do you have Dr. Oz there?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. Kind of an annoying guy, but still, I did the show. He was sweet enough. But he introduced three people in a row as fighting their demons. I said, does anybody win? Does anybody ever beat up the demon? So apparently everybody and their brother's fighting demons, mm-hmm. and they don't have to be famous to do it.
True. Well, you have proven that they can be beaten and that you can have a pretty amazing life afterwards. You visited the house recently that was the Partridge family home. What sort of flashbacks did you get there? And is it true Shirley Jones once sent you to your room, but there wasn't actually a room to go to?
This was because I just took my wife to see that. It's on Blondie Street is the name of it at Columbia Ranch Studios. And we just went and we saw it. It was really nice. And I pointed that spot out to my wife. And here's what was happening. I was being a jerk. Imagine you had made a kid super famous. And now I was going to be a jerk about it, apparently. And she'd had enough of me. And finally said, Danny, you go to your room. And she pointed to the stairs and everything kind of stopped. Because who's going to tell the Academy Award winner that there's no upstairs? And finally, everybody just laughed and went about their business. I don't think Shirley loves that story, but it's fun. It's fun and it's factual.